Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Cobra Queen, Pandora English, Book 4. Written by Tara Moss and read by Luci Christian. For Burnt. Chapter 1. What is a spirit guide? I typed my query into the search engine on my work computer and glanced furtively around the open plan office. On finding that I was unobserved, I sat down low in my chair and pressed enter. This was no mere work query. This was, well, personal. It was only 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a Tuesday, and I was at the boutique New York fashion magazine where I work. Despite our shared name, my only actual connection with the magazine is my unglamorous position as assistant to the editor. But I do look deceptively important on my business card. Pandora English, Pandora Magazine. I wasn't above milking that coincidence when I needed to. Short of lying, of course. I'm no good at lying. I don't have a lot of work experience, but I know it's frowned upon to surf the internet during paid work hours. Thing is, I don't have a computer at home, and I don't have the internet either. Nervously, I chewed the inside of my lip and clicked on the first search result that came up. A spirit guide is defined as an entity that remains a disincarnate spirit in order to act as a guide or protector to a living incarnated human being. Disincarnate? Lieutenant Luke wasn't always disincarnate. Sometimes he was really quite carnate indeed. He was very handsome and attentive, and, well, the thought of his carnate moments made my cheeks hot. We had a very special date in just 2 nights, on the blue moon. I'd been looking forward to it all month. I licked my upper lip, which had suddenly become dry, and continued reading. Spirit guide can also refer to totems, angels, guardian angels. I guess I could think of Lieutenant Luke as a guardian angel. I liked that idea, actually. Still, what did that mean exactly? That he would push me out of the way of speeding trains or stop me from stepping off cliffs? He'd come to my aid in the past, and mine to his for that matter. But why did I have a spirit guide at all? What were the rules of engagement here? Is it ethically okay to date your guardian angel? Was that done? I had a serious crush on my spirit guide, and I didn't know what to do about it for a bunch of reasons. Not least was that I had something like a boyfriend already. His name was Jay Rockwell, and he was nice and rather handsome and tall, if a bit embarrassingly wealthy. Oh, and sometimes he didn't remember me. Paranormal erasure, long story. But by regular world standards, he was what people commonly called a catch. Plus, you know, he was alive. The whole issue of dating two men at once was awkward, when only one knew about the other, and only one was living, and my life was complicated. The door opened behind me, and I closed the search browser so fast you couldn't even see my hand move. Pepper, I declared, and stood bolt upright. Pepper Smith was the editor of Pandora, and my boss. She was bright, fashionably thin, and highly caffeinated, and today she wore her ice-blonde hair in a severe bun, right on the top of her head. I think fashion types called it a topknot. Her lightweight sweater was a striking emerald green, and she wore dark denim finished with a matching green stitch. She was wearing black platform boots with cutouts that showed off fuchsia, pedicured toenails. I was pretty sure I'd never seen Pepper in the same thing twice, and today was no exception. I stood to attention in front of her, and she raised a pale, sculpted eyebrow at me. "What's up with you?" "Sorry, nothing," I said, and leaned back against the edge of my cubicle, faux casual. She eyed me suspiciously. "You are a strange girl." There was no comeback for that, really. "Can you work late tonight?" she asked. "Tonight?" I found myself nodding automatically, though I suspected I would be exhausted by nightfall. I'd been up late with my, Well, my spirit guide slash guardian angel slash sometime other boyfriend. Can you tell I'm feeling guilty? It had become a bit heated. His lips were like sweet mist, and when he kissed me, I felt like I was floating. Don't get me started. Suffice to say, sleep was a thing of the past since I'd moved to New York. Certainly I can work late, I replied. The fashion shoot has moved. We're shooting at the Temple of Dendur, but we can't get in until after dark, my boss explained. Oh, I blinked. The Temple of Dendur was quite familiar, though I'd never seen it in person. For the Egyptian-themed shoot? My boss said with a hint of impatience. Yes, I replied, because I knew precisely which shoot she meant and why the Temple of Dendur would be the perfect location. This summer would apparently be all about ancient Egyptian-themed fashion, Cleopatra and the like, and we were devoting most of an issue to the look, which included chunky gold jewelry, winged eye makeup, sandals worn with long dresses that draped luxuriously, or skin-tight mummy bandage dresses for the bodycon types. That was an important fashion term now, bodycon, as in conscious. I'd been regarded as somewhat clueless when I'd asked what it meant. The big shoot had been organized for Thursday at a studio nearby in Soho, and I knew when and where because I had organized it on Pepper's behalf. But since then, it seemed she'd have a favor come through, and everything had changed. That's good then, isn't it? I ventured, wondering how we could fit in a planned 8-hour shoot in one night. Of course it's good, she replied. But time is short now. The Metropolitan Museum of Art's Temple of Dendur. The Met had a famous Egyptology section, including a temple for Isis and Osiris, the gods of resurrection and the afterlife. The more I thought about it, the more a strange cocktail of delight and fear took hold of me. I knew about the place. My mother had talked about it. What time am I to be there? We have an 8:30 start time for the first look, after the sun goes down, my boss informed me. You'll arrive at 7 and start the setup with the photographer. There's a lot of glass in there. Astrid will have to put up backdrops. I had yet to attend a photo shoot that took less than 4 hours, and I knew for a fact that we had a lot of looks to shoot. Oh, it would be a late night then. Another one, but this time with no Lieutenant Luke as an inducement. Still, I'd always wanted to see the Temple of Dendur in person, since I was a kid, actually. And more importantly, I could use the extra pay. Pepper was good about things like paying overtime, though her predecessor, Sky DeVille, had not been. Sky had sure pushed the boundaries of proper employer conduct on a few occasions, and that was even before she'd become a bloodsucker. Can Morticia come? I blurted. The receptionist, Morticia, is my friend. In fact, she is my only true normal girlfriend in New York, though you wouldn't think so with a name like that. I didn't particularly like the idea of hanging around late at night at the Met, which is at the corner of Central Park. I hoped I didn't need to explain why. It wasn't the threat of muggers, actually, but I was happy for Pepper to think that. My boss hesitated. Her pale, steely eyes took in the front desk for a moment. Well, that is a good idea, I suppose. We could use an extra set of hands if we plan to get out of there by midnight. Yes. I relaxed a touch. 7 o'clock sharp at the main entrance to the Met on 82nd and 5th, Pepper said. She turned around and walked back into her office. Just before she closed the door behind her, she gave me another curious look. I thought she was going to say something, but she just looked me up and down and then disappeared, the door making a faint click behind her. Strange girl, I could imagine her thinking. She didn't know the half of it. It was just past 5 as I descended the stairwell from the office, pushed the heavy street door open, and stepped out onto the Manhattan sidewalk. Soho's Spring Street was busy, as always, and after growing up in sleepy Gretchenville, population 3,999 with my recent departure, I was not quite used to the pace of Manhattan yet. It was hardly the biggest change I'd had to get used to since moving to the Big Apple, but there was something about the constant noise and movement of pedestrians and cars that took adjustment. Even in my great-aunt's mansion in Spectre, which was far uptown and curiously quiet, you could often hear the distant sounds of sirens late into the night. It wasn't for nothing that they called New York the city that never sleeps. The sky was still bright, which was a nice change after my first Manhattan winter, and on this particular warm late spring afternoon, the business people and arty types who pushed past me on the sidewalk wore suits with the jackets off, or short-sleeved t-shirts or dresses. The days were already longer and gloriously alive. I wondered how long the sun would shine, and the people of Manhattan would remain oblivious to the supernatural trouble that was stirring. And it was stirring. I had no doubt of it anymore. I looked up into the sky, half expecting to see the creature who had taken me up there one night. "It's going to be nice out tonight," came a voice behind me, and I whirled around. It was my friend, the receptionist Morticia. She was standing in front of the Evolution store, next to the full-sized medical-grade skeleton that guarded their door. The skeleton was holding a sale sign, and the wind caught it, making the plastic bones rattle. I took a breath, pushing aside all the things I couldn't tell my friend, all the things that now, conjured by the sight of those bones, flitted around my head like unwelcome shadows. "Did you buy something?" I asked. The Evolution store had some real human skulls, along with the medical-grade replicas. The shop window was lined with Venus flytraps and dead butterflies in frames. A stuffed warthog stared at me through the window with lifeless glass eyes. It was an unusual shop, and Morticia was often drawn to it. I was too, though these days I'd had my fill of the dark and weird. "Nope, just, looking," she said, and joined me on the sidewalk, though I could have sworn she had a large book behind her back that she slid into her satchel. She seemed not to want to share the tome with me, so I didn't ask about it. I folded my arms, suddenly cold. "Hey, is it okay that I roped you into coming tonight? I would have totally understood if you'd said no. I kind of volunteered you without even asking. Sorry if it was the wrong call." "Are you kidding me? You know I've always wanted to be on one of the shoots. Plus, I love the Met." Morticia drew out the O in love, gesticulating dramatically with both hands to make her point. "It is the most awesome place ever." Though Morticia had rather a penchant for exaggeration, we had a fair number of similarities, all things considered. She was about my age and height, and neither of us had a lot of friends or much of a relationship with our parents. The reasons were quite different. She was on bad terms with her folks, whereas mine were dead. Dead, dead, not undead. And there is a big difference, let me tell you. Also, we were both alive, which is a category I've begun to pay attention to lately. But the similarities probably ended there. She was a bit of a goth and she had a tattoo. And though I had never dyed my light brown hair, she changed her color a lot. At the moment, her shaggy hair was dyed a stark raven black, so black it was almost blue. Last month, it had been the color of red food dye. I tended to wear vintage hand-me-downs from my great-aunt, who'd been a designer in the 40s and 50s, whereas Morticia always seemed to wear the same black dress, striped tights, and Doc Martens. With her panda black eye makeup and gangly olive oil build, she was the antithesis of pretty much everyone else who worked at Pandora. I liked that about her. And her name was deceiving. She'd changed it from B to Morticia, probably despite her parents. But she was just a normal young woman living in Jersey and working the front desk at Pandora. Meanwhile, I had the slightly less odd name of Pandora, having evidently been named after the woman in Greek mythology who opened a box and let all the evil into the world. Yet I lived in a strange suburb on Adams Avenue, a street named for Charles Adams, the Adams family creator and creator of Morticia's chosen namesake. I hadn't yet told Morticia about that. nor had I mentioned to her that Mr. Adams himself was a resident of the suburb I lived in. And by resident, I mean that he buys his newspaper from the same store I do, no matter that he passed away in the late 80s. "I thought you might enjoy it," I said, looking down at my scuffed ballet flats. "I remembered you saying that you'd never been to one of the fashion shoots before, and you wanted to." "I was always keen, but Sky never asked me," she admitted. Even hearing my previous boss's name made me sneer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.